video game consoles. Before the optical disc, and before video game cartridges, we had the dedicated console, the very first video game machines. No external media. Here we have the Retrobit generation, a dedicated console. A fairly small console. I'm going to talk about the Retrobit Generations controller, which doesn't just work with the Retrobit Generations, it can be used with your personal computer. It's a USB style controller. So I am going to talk about the controller, that's going to be the main focus of this video, but as a bonus, I am going to talk about some video games as well. Some of the video games which can be found on the Retrobit Generation. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the Retrobit Generation. This console is packed with over 100 games, and it's my intention to take a look at some of those games, perhaps in a couple different videos where we can focus on how those video games compare to, well, previous versions of those games on the original hardware. Since this is a recreation, or I should say a little emulation box, with Nintendo Entertainment System, Sega Genesis, Nintendo Game Boy, and Super Nintendo games, as well as some arcade games. And while it is my intention to see how well these games turned out, this console is known for not emulating the original games very well. However, some of them do turn out alright, some do not. A lot of people are disappointed with this controversial device. However, before I get into the games, I want to do a little prequel. I want to talk about the interface with this device. Yeah, the controllers. Because while a lot of people were disappointed with the emulation in this device, I'm going to take a look at something that actually is fairly well praised. The controllers. I am somebody who really likes vehicles, especially compact cars. Fuel efficient, lightweight, agile, compact cars. And, well, as somebody that likes vehicles, perhaps I'll just take a quick look to see. Hey, here we go. There's a little pleasant distraction in the Retrobit Generations. Maybe we'll take a look at this car game. And I do believe this is a Super Famicom game, or Super Nintendo game. And what sort of a car do we get? It's kind of interesting looking. Looks like it actually has a decent front bumper. And well, the headlights are kind of nice, kind of like a neon. And this game, as you can notice, it's very, very... Well, it has a very spirit of promoting Africa. Yeah, it's very emotionally African. Even though I believe it's actually a Japanese game, made to be marketed in Japan. Alright, here we go. The game seems to have pretty good music, but then again, I don't really know what it sounds like played on an actual Super Nintendo or Super Famicom, so it's hard to say. And, well, gameplay's pretty good, not bad. Nice little distraction. These crashes are kind of weird, but it gives you a chance to get a good look at the car. Kind of a nice looking car anyway. Anyway, so, get back up to speed. Now, is this the sort of game you can just go wide open without slowing down? What'll happen if we just try to drive wide open? Yep, you're pretty much destined to crash if you just go wide open. You're gonna have to slow down every now and then, but that's pretty common for any sort of race car game. All in all, it's kind of a cool game. I kind of like its 16-bit environments. I like it. It's a nice distraction. I can't really say if it's amazing or not. I guess I'm not going to get into too much detail on this one. It's a nice distraction, but I don't actually have the Super Famicom version of this game, so I don't really know how it holds up to the game when it's played on the original hardware. And win or lose, this game really does promote the spirit of Africa, or at least that seems to be what it's going for. And nothing wrong with that. I like it when games have a very worldly feel to them. They feel like they're really promoting part of the world, or an environment, or a feeling. Okay, so let's get back to talking about the controller. Yeah, the controller for the Retrobit generations.
How you interface with this game system is pretty important. And while emulation on the Retrobit generations isn't really perfect, something that does stand out is that it comes with two USB controllers that are Sega Genesis style. I've used the Sega Genesis controller and the Super Nintendo controller a lot over the years, as well as the Nintendo Entertainment System controller. And of the three of them, yeah, the Genesis controller is the better. And I definitely really enjoyed playing Nintendo Entertainment System games on the Super Retro Trio with the Sega Genesis controller, which is an option on one version of the Super Retro Trio. But that's getting off topic. This controller here, that comes with the Retrobit generations, that's definitely a good move on their part. And it's USB, so it's compatible with your personal computers. And I found it worked great with these Sega Mega Drive Classic Collection games. Both of them, it'll work fine with them. As far as I can tell, I haven't had any problems. I had to remap the buttons when I used this controller, though. But one thing this controller would not work with was Another World, also known as Out of This World. Another World just does not recognize the D-pad. That said, Another World had no trouble recognizing the D-pad on this. This is the Retrolink Sega Saturn-style controller. Another USB controller. And while that controller worked great with Another World, it also worked great with the Sega Mega Drive Classics collections. The Retrobit Generations controller, that one just didn't work with Another World. So if you want a controller that's going to work with a wide variety of PC games, the Retrolink controller is still the better choice. It's a great controller. It's made by the same people that make the Retrobit generations. Retrolink and Retrobit are basically the same company. They're both trademarks of cool brands. So yeah, it's not the best USB controller you can get for PC games. That said, when I plugged the Retrobit controller into my PC, it referred to it as a USB controller, but there was a slash and PS3 in the title. So it was also a PlayStation 3 controller, according to my personal computer. So I plugged this Sega Genesis style controller into my PlayStation 3, and it worked. I had no trouble scrolling through the menus. I even loaded up a game of Sonic the Hedgehog and played it. So while I did have better success with a variety of games working with the Retrolink controller, the Retrobit controller, or the Retrobit Generations controller, it just doesn't want to recognize the directional pad when with Another World, for whatever reason, and other games will probably have the same problem. It actually works as a PlayStation 3 controller, so that's a pretty good bonus. One of these controllers is probably the better choice for PC games, or at least a wide variety of PC games, personal computer games. But the other one, the one that came with the Retrobit generations, that one works great with the PlayStation 3. And if the game is compatible with it, like the Mega Drive Classic Collection here, well, then it's also a great controller for that as well, too. I like that the Retrolink controller is a little bit larger. something that's a great feature, especially when playing Nintendo Entertainment System games with a Sega Genesis-style controller, is using the mode button as a select button. These controllers are just a little bit smaller than the proper Sega Genesis controller. And as such, it's actually easier to click the mode button, even if it's not more visible. It's actually easier clicking the mode button on the proper Sega Genesis controller. Just something about the length of a person's fingers and the size of the controller. It's just easier on the bigger controller. That said, it's not actually a problem on the Retrobit generation's smaller controller. It just feels more natural than the actual Sega Genesis controller. This slightly larger controller with bigger left and right buttons, if the right button was mapped to work as the mode button, that'd be perfect, actually. So I do wish these Retrobit generations controllers were a little bit bigger. Now that said, as I discovered, this was a PlayStation 3 controller, as well as a USB PC controller. That led me to think, I'm going to try the PlayStation 3 controller in the Retrobit generations. Since I always use my PlayStation 3 controller wired, so I don't have to worry about recharging it, no problem. I just grabbed my controller, unplugged it from the PlayStation 3, plugged it into the Retrobit generations, and what happened? Nothing. Nothing. And of course, I also tried this Retrolink controller with the Retrobit generations, and that did not work either. So far, no USB controller that I tried would work with the Retrobit generations other than the controllers that came with it. I even tried the Xbox 360 controller. The Xbox 360 controller, when plugged into the Retrobit generations, well, the ring in the center will light up. It gets power, but it doesn't do anything. I even tried this random PC controller that I have that's also USB. And I got that one used. I don't think it works very well anyway. And that one did not work with the Retrobit generations either. Nothing that I plugged into the Retrobit generations other than the controllers that come with it will work with it. So if you were determined to plug a USB Super Nintendo style controller into this thing, or a Sega Saturn style controller into it, just to get a different style controller, nothing works with the Retrobit generations, at least nothing that I have found, and that's including USB controllers that are made by the same people. Nothing has worked with it except for the ones that came with it. So if you want a replacement controller, you're going to have to get the controllers special for the Retrobit generations. At least that's been my experience. I have found nothing that will work with the Retrobit generations other than the controllers that come with it. So, the Retrobit generations, it comes with a controller that is a great option to have on hand for your personal computer. Don't expect it to work with everything that previously worked with directional pads. Unlike with this Retrolink controller, where the D-pad works great with games like Another World. Games like Another World do not recognize the D-pad on these Retrobit Generations controllers. But that said, the Sega Mega Drive games here on this Classics Collection disc, or the other one that's under those controllers, those games do work with it. It's worth mentioning, and this is important when using a Sega Genesis controller to control Super Nintendo games, not all games are going to have their buttons lined up in a way that is perfect for a Sega Genesis controller, but that said, if you can remap the buttons, you should be able to find an excellent setup when using Sega Genesis style controllers with old 2D video games. That said, going into the menu in this thing to reassign buttons, I found it just seems a little bit awkward keeping track of which button is really what button when you're... I don't know how to describe it, but there's just something that is counterintuitive about the way that you're setting up the buttons. Now, with the Retrobit, or Retrobit's own Super Retro Trio, the default when using a Sega Genesis controller to control Super Nintendo games would put the X button as the L button and the Z button as the R button. That is logical and it works very well. It's not going to work for every game, but for the most part, that's probably the best default setup. This controller, which is remappable, of course, in the software, in the Retrobit Generation's internal software. This controller, though, the way it's set up, the default usage of the L and R buttons are moved to the Z button and the C button, which I consider to be weird and awkward. It kind of makes sense in a way. It has A, B, X, and Y as your main face buttons. But yeah, it doesn't work as good as what you would expect if you were plugging a Sega Genesis controller into the Super Retro Trio to play Super Nintendo games. But that's just the default settings. They can be changed. Alright, let's see what we can find of good games that I might actually be able to play on original hardware. And yes, this game system is known for bad emulation. For example, there was a really good seller on eBay who was very open about how bad the Retrobit Generations was, at least in his opinion, and in many other people's opinions, when I bought it. So right from the start, I knew what I was getting into if I hadn't already read about the system. But if we were to scroll through the various games on this thing, taking a look for something to check out, perhaps something that I can also play on my actual Sega Genesis. Let's see, as we scroll through a whole bunch of games, and there's a lot of games. Some people have complained that there's a lot of homebrew crap mixed in with the titles that they want, but I think everything adds to the collection, whether it's good or bad, as long as you have good games in there, but let's not pretend that they're all good. The Yang Warrior Family, which has recently been translated under other names. Okay, let's take a look at this game. And this game is actually a pretty good game. Pyko, I believe they're just responsible for translating it. Fairly decent intro. And right from the intro, if you have the chance to also check it out on the Sega Genesis or Sega Mega Drive, the actual hardware that this game was originally designed for, you'll notice some differences. Differences in speed, speed of the music especially. I find it plays better on the actual Genesis, but it actually does play pretty good on this Retrobit Generations console. So let's just switch over and take a look at how it looks on an actual Sega Genesis for a moment. And you know, my video capture didn't agree with the Sega Genesis quite as well as I think it did the Retrobit Generations, because I didn't really notice that difference. Things look kind of whited out a bit on the Genesis compared to the Retrobit Generations. But I think part of that is my video capture method. It seems to make it look different here, as I thought it looked pretty good on the screen at home. But just the opening theme here, you can tell the difference in music and tone and speed. That seems a little better paced on the actual Sega Genesis here, as opposed to if we go back to the Retrobit Generations. Yeah, so the speed is off a little bit too much, I think, for the Retrobit Generations. Looks a little darker on the Retrobit Generations, too. Though this actually is a pretty good game, I do like the intro, and it is a very fun game, though I do find it does play better on the actual Sega Genesis. What's interesting about this game is it goes into the old history of China. Yeah, it goes back into the past of China, which is kind of cool. Another game that has something to do with part of the world. It's based on a famous story from China. And if you like beat-em-up style gameplay, well, as you can see, this might just be the game for you. It does have pretty good intros.
pretty good animation, anyway. And yeah, of course, the Retrobit Generations gives us a translated version of it. And I do think story is important, so I do like seeing things in English, because English is the language that I know. And there you have a variety of characters to pick between. And here's even a sample of gameplay. But you know, when I think of this game and the history of ancient China, it wasn't that long ago I took a look at another game. Actually, it is a while back now. I rushed out a video in my dusty room. I hurried. I didn't even have time to clean up the dust.
Alright. And there it is. There's not too much special. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people keep these and some of them disappear, but a little foam rubber thing. Disc. No scratches.
Yeah, I can't help but think back to the time I did a video about Romance of the Three Kingdoms on the Sega Saturn, which was a pretty good game, which deals with the history of China even further back than this game. Yeah, they're both based on historical stories from China. So I can't help but think of this video as an accidental sequel to that video, just because of that. And Romance of the Three Kingdoms is a pretty good game, and the version of it on the Sega Saturn was pretty cool as well, too. Definitely a video I would look forward to taking a look at again sometime soon. However, at the moment, I'm kinda dealing with the Retrobit Generations, not the Sega Saturn. So, getting back to the Retrobit Generations, yeah, this is a pretty competent beat-em-up. It is a pretty good, I guess you'd call this the beat-em-up genre. Pick up food to heal your character as they take damage and fight your way through crowds of people. And you can play one player or two. It's not that often I have a second player with me when I'm playing these games, so I very often do end up playing one player. The characters that I found work the best, the two guys with weapons I find pretty useful. Even the guy who just fights bare-fisted is pretty useful. Unfortunately, they didn't make the female character very strong in this. Which is unfortunate, because she seemed like a very agile and interesting character, and a very nice character design. The guy with the big pole arm, that large-bladed weapon on a pole, he's a pretty useful character to use. The guy with the sword I also kind of like, the guy that wears a lot of blue. Definitely has a very good character design. And the characters tend to bounce. If you're playing two players, you really have to be cautious of, where your ally is on the screen, because if you have your enemies bouncing around on the screen, sometimes they'll bump into your friend as well. And the bouncing is actually more noticeable on the Genesis, playing it on the actual Genesis hardware. But then again, it could be just that I noticed that more because when I played this on the actual Genesis hardware, that was the time that I played this two-player, as opposed to going through a one-player battle. Alright, so yeah. If you're wondering whether I'm playing this on the Retrobit Generations or if I'm playing it on the Sega Genesis hardware, well, for convenience, that was quite a glitch. For the convenience of telling the difference, right here, I'm playing one player, and I'm doing it on the Retrobit Generations. However, some of the gameplay footage that I did from the Sega Genesis, using the actual Sega Genesis hardware, well, I did that two players. That's right. So if we go back to the Sega Genesis with its excellent introduction, but lack of English, well, there's still a little English there. Here we go, two players. And I had help from Shadow. Wolf of Shadows helped me with this video by doing a little bit of gameplay. And playing video games isn't usually her sort of thing. She doesn't play them very often, but she did excellent at this game. So I'll be playing as player one and Shadow as player two in the two-player version of, well, I shouldn't say two-player version of this, on the Sega Genesis hardware. So when you see two players on the screen, that's the Sega Genesis. Oops, they accidentally grabbed each other. Just getting used to the controls there. And yeah, it's really easy to bounce into each other. And actually, that was the first time I played at two players as well, myself. I didn't even know if we could hurt each other. But yeah, that is something we can do. It is possible for you to harm your ally in two-player mode. And I do find it easier on the Sega Genesis than I do on the Retrobit Generations. But that said, it might actually be easier to beat it on the Retrobit Generations. I'll get to that after a bit here. Kind of easier to beat it on the Retrobit Generations, mostly due to accident. Boss fights are pretty good. When you get right down to it, many things about it is kind of a standard beat-em-up gameplay, but still good. Good enough for you to play it one player and enjoy it even more two player. But I do find it does play a little bit better on the actual Sega Genesis. But that said, you might actually want to know the story. And if you're like me, living in North America, speaking English, well, it's a lot easier to understand it if you're playing it on the Retrobit Generations, because they translated it for you. And the original game on the Sega Genesis, technically Sega Mega Drive in the region it came from, is, I believe, in Chinese. I believe it was made without being licensed by Sega, so some would call it an unlicensed game in China. If I know the history of this game correctly, I'm not completely sure about that. But the story is told out in characters, spelling things out in the same letters used by the people both of China and Japan. And I believe that it's actually Chinese, but I could be wrong, it might be Japanese. But, played on the Retrobit Generations, and you have the Roman Latin alphabet spelling things out in English. And since I know English, it's a little easier for me to understand what's going on when playing it on the Retrobit Generations. But that said, you could pick up on the story in the Retrobit Generations, then play it on the Sega Genesis, and perhaps enjoy the slightly better gameplay that's paced a little bit better on the Sega Genesis. And it is easier to play through on the Sega Genesis, I said that before. Thus, from what little I've played of the game thus far, I've actually gotten farther on the Sega Genesis, playing it that way as opposed to playing it on the Retrobit Generations. Part of that could be because I had a little help from a friend. That always helps. I like playing these games two players, and it does make things more fun. And of course, you have an excellent continue screen, which is a chance to select a new player. This guy is my favorite character animations of any of them. But I do find it odd that even when he punches air, even if his fist doesn't make connection, it still goes thump. I always thought that was kind of odd. I also thought it was odd that when you, I mean, you use your sword, but it's after you swipe, after you take so many punches. I mean, I should say after you perform so many punches, he uses his sword. Yeah, it's like he punches once or twice, then he does a swipe with a sword. Well, not this guy. This guy has the big, huge blade on a pole. Pole arms. Which can be useful weapons, apparently. This guy uses it quite well. Yeah, a lot of the boss fights in this are pretty interesting. Yeah, overall, it's just a good game with a lot of good scenery. I mean, you're not going to find it to be the most amazing game out there, but it is a good collection. Or, I shouldn't say good collection. It is a good addition to anybody's video game collection. So I am glad to have this game on the Retrobit Generations, and it is very much playable on the Retrobit Generations. So while I do have a slight preference to the gameplay, playing it on the Sega Genesis, which is basically the hardware it was intended for originally, the Retrobit Generations might not be perfect, but does an alright job of emulating it. Now, take a look here. That's usually what happens when you get beaten to the point where you no longer have any health. But here's an easy way to beat the game. Yeah, at this point, I take a hit so hard it knocks me into the end of the game. Yeah, I won't give you all the spoilers at the moment, but yeah, that knocked me right into the end of the game. Now, how about we take a look at an arcade game? Yeah, Varth. Varth seems like it's a pretty cool game. Yeah, by Capcom? Yeah, don't you wish you were playing this on the Retrobit Generations? And if you have a Retrobit Generations, you would be wishing you were playing it like this. Yeah, I am playing this on the Retrobit Generations here. But there is something a little bit different. Something that makes a lot of people really disappointed in playing Varth on the Retrobit Generations. It looks like a pretty cool game. I don't know a lot about the backstory, but apparently it's kind of science fiction-y. Even if it looks like your airplane looks kind of, I wouldn't say old-fashioned-y exactly, but it doesn't really look super futuristic either. But the environments do look kind of futuristic or dystopian. But yeah, this game, Varth, very cool-looking game anyway. Looks like a great arcade game. So what's wrong with it? Well, the problem is, when you play it on the Retrobit Generations, you don't play it like this. You play it like... Okay. Let's see if you can see what's wrong with this video game. What's wrong with this picture? Any second. Oh yeah, there. You're probably already tilting your head, both in confusion and to get a better look at things. It looks kinda cool, but looks very wrong. Yeah, the presentation for this game is a little bit awkward. Yeah. You know, playing as though your ship or plane or advanced futuristic aircraft is flying on a different angle, no problem. Whether you're going from down to up or from left to right, both are okay ways to play a shooter game. But just looking at this is just wrong. Yeah, it's hard not to look at this and just find it completely wrong. You're going to be confused looking at this. It's very playable. It is very playable. It's still an enjoyable game, but the presentation, as you can tell, is just wrong. Very wrong. A lot of people have a problem with this. You know, it is still very much playable. But that said, no, this is just wrong. It should have put an option to turn this on its side. You see, some games that would take advantage of the fact you'd be better off with a video screen that is more tall than wide. Some video games actually were designed to work with the monitor on its side. This was one of those games, but when you're playing it on a TV at home that you're not gonna want to tip over, this is just wrong. Power up. Still a pretty enjoyable game. I mean, just when you look at every word on the screen and the perspective, you can tell you're meant to be viewing this on a very different angle. And that's just wrong. So there's no surprise some people have a problem with this game as it is presented on the Retrobit Generations. Cool game, yes. Just not quite the proper presentation, not on the right angle. Well, you know I like vehicles. I said it before. And that's not just limited to cars. It could also be spacecraft. Yeah, I like spacecraft. And something that has turned out well on the Retrobit Generations is it does emulate Game Boy games very well. I'm not sure if that applies to Game Boy Advance or not, but as far as I can tell, this is a Game Boy Advance game. And yeah, this is another game I cannot compare to the original hardware, but let's end this on a happy note. This game is really cool. I actually really enjoyed this one, World Reborn. Since I'm all about the story, and I'm actually playing this, well, not for the first time, but it's still fairly new to me, I'm going to go with easy. Because I'm all about the story, and the story in this is pretty cool. Sort of a dystopian future. Yeah, humanity is suffering due to technology gone wrong. It's actually not got a bad story. And you know what, for this type of game, for the limited amount you're exposed to the characters in the game actually are pretty good. It has some role-playing game elements, but mainly, it's basically a space shooter. Well, three-dimensional space you're traveling in, a two-dimensional style gameplay, even inside an atmosphere of a planet, you're still kind of in three-dimensional space, so the word space does still kind of apply, I guess. But no, it's more of an atmospheric combat game than a space shooter, I guess. Still a shooter, or shoot 'em up. Some people call them shmups. I never want to say that word again. But yeah, a shoot 'em up. A spaceship shooting. Kind of like a space shooter. You can take different routes, and depending on which character you pick and which ship you pick, will determine which character's abilities and which ship level up. So you can improve your ship as well as the skills of your pilot. The gameplay I actually really like. The music and the visuals are pretty cool. This is actually a very enjoyable game. And I can't compare it to the original version because I don't have the original version, but I believe it is for the Game Boy Advance. And to the best of my knowledge, the Retrobit Generations does Game Boy Advance emulation excellent. It's known for doing Game Boy emulation excellent. Even if a little less so on the side of Nintendo, Super Nintendo, and Sega Genesis. But yeah, this game's pretty cool. For what little you see of the characters, they seem likable. You get passwords if you want to write down passwords to continue your game. That's kind of cool. Yeah, not a lot to say about it, but I enjoyed this game. And if you have a Retrobit Generations, and you're looking for one of the games that is really good quality, really enjoyable, and if you like space shooter style games, even if they involve combat in an atmosphere, then I recommend World Reborn. It plays well on the Retrobit Generations. So this game system, the Retrobit Generations, it definitely has some good stuff. This game is one of those, well, it's some of that good stuff. This game is good. I recommend it. So there definitely is some good things for me to say about the Retrobit Generations. And it definitely comes with an excellent controller, which will work great with, you know, some games on your personal computer. It's usable with a PlayStation 3. So the controller that comes with this system is pretty good. It does have some good games. It also has some crap. No doubt about that. There are definitely problems with this system. But there is some good to be found within it. And the controller is excellent. The controller is excellent. And like I said, it can be used with a PlayStation 3 or a personal computer. Though my personal experience with it has showed me that not every game that I used it with on the personal computer worked well with it. With a controller, that is. But hey, two excellent USB Sega Genesis style controllers. That's not bad. Some great games. A whole lot of crap in there too. The Retrobit Generations, it has a bit of a bad name, but it's not all bad. Like, some people look negatively upon it. So I'm not going to strongly recommend it, but I'm not going to tell you to stay away from it either. Just look to see if there's anything in there to make it worth purchasing, make it worth the price for you, and then consider getting it. And hey, you get two pretty good controllers that come with it. And I do plan to go back and talk about this device more in the future. And so, feel free to check out more of my videos. I have other videos out there. I consider them the Unimultiverse Archives.